Macmillan Audio presents Deep Roots by Ruthanna Emrys. Read for you by Gabra, Zackman. Prologue. Ngitv of the Outer Ones, May 1949. There is a world, a planetoid chosen for ease of camouflage among thousands like it, where wind whispers through air cold as the vacuum. The nearest star is a distant candle. Radar, radiation, subtle folds of gravity. These are the best ways to perceive the cities tucked into crevices, the spiderweb bridges spanning jags of icy mountain. The bridges, eons old, were here when we arrived. They offered omen and reminder. Life persists everywhere. Life vanishes everywhere. Find it and listen, or it will pass unknown. I spread my wings, furl my claws, and spring from Yuggoth into the void behind and between worlds. Here is neither cold nor heat, only form. Shimmers of color, more perfect than any permitted by surface physics, mark direction. Bubbling shapes carry messages left by travelers past and yet to come. From deeper still drifts a faint fluting. The pounding, pulsating trill wavers on the edge of understanding. Pay too close attention, and the friction will wear your mind smooth. Conversation between winged and wingless is our best distraction from that distant melody. Embodied travel mates fly beside me. The disembodied, in their canisters, come encircled in our clasped limbs. Amid reality's foundations, we speak with equal ease of the deepest philosophy and the most immediate gossip. We break through the dimensional membrane on the edge of atmosphere. Through heat and wind, I plummet, extending just enough of myself to enjoy the physicality of speed, before landing lightly on a granite cliff shadowed by pines. Here, on a hill that humans avoid as much from habit as from half-remembered fear, I feel the mining colony shifting beneath me. Travelmates and crossmates and offspring and research clusters, the ever-changing rivalries and friendships and political debates through which we adapt to this place as to a trillion others. Soon there will be a shorter journey to our new delved mine. In a city richer and denser than any human habitation we've dared before. Soon there will be new recruits who can help us understand what's happening on this world we've adopted, and unwelcome insight into what we must do about it. But for now, I am in Vermont, and I am home. Chapter 1. June 1949. Grand Central Station stretched beyond human scale, and the crowd within matched it. Amid the swift current of travelers, Neko held tight to my hand, even as she craned to glimpse columns and golden statues. Trumbull and Audrey and Dee Dee took the lead, a confident V to navigate the turbulence. I trailed in their narrow wake, overwhelmed by the stench of 1,000 perfumes, 1,000 joys and worries and attractions, 1,000 bodies flavoring New York's overpowered air.
This way,
Audrey called back. She led us toward an archway.
How can you tell?
Caleb muttered.
Let's hope she knows, said Charlie. We can't very well stop to check.
His cane thumped the marble floor as he worked to keep up. He was right. Audrey's speed merely kept us in pace with the crowd.
You have to know, she called back cheerfully. Otherwise, you get lost.
After the first shock, the crowd began to resolve into people, variety too great to seem truly monolithic. There were pale-skinned women in well-fitted dresses and neatly jacketed men like those who dominated Arkham, others whose features reminded me of Morecambe County's Polish communities. Such immigrants, I'd been told as a child, would make signs against the curse they saw in our faces. But it was the long-settled descendants of Puritans whose superstitions were most dangerous. Beyond these familiar types, I saw every kind of face and dress I'd encountered in San Francisco, and a few I hadn't. Scandalously short skirts and faces hidden by scarves, eyes heavy-browed or framed as neatly as my Nikkei family's, fabulous beards and unlikely hats. A woman who barely came up to my shoulder carved a determined path with a pram, cooing at her child and glaring at all who brushed too close. Two clean-shaven Negro men in brown robes backed against a pillar, bent over maps they protected with jutting elbows. A rotund white man carried a trombone under one arm and hoisted a bag of papers with the other. He checked his watch and hastened his step. In Arkham and Boston, we'd drawn stares, for my face or Audrey's magnetizing effect on men, or for the variation within our group. Here we received only the scant attention needed to avoid collisions. I began to believe that we might really, after so many false leads, discover some distant cousins overlooked by the government during Innsmouth's destruction. Our expatriates could easily have settled here unremarked. And so they might remain, if the press of the station gave any taste of what awaited us outside.
There it is.
Audrey pointed above the sea of heads, and when I stood on tiptoe, I could see the pillar of the station clock where Spectre had promised to meet us. In the grand hall surrounding our landmark, I pulled even closer to the others. Trumbull glanced back.
Look up.
I drew breath. Above, across the vast ceiling, stretched a painted sky. It was stylized, constellations imposed on line drawings of Pegasus and Ram and Skittering Crab. These stars were trod by the comprehensible human image gods to which the station was a temple, not the distant suns that birthed mine. And still, it was holy. Caleb glanced at Professor Trumbull.
Are there cities like this?
She smiled.
This is as close as humans come to the Yith's capital.
I wondered how close the comparison came, what remembered glories she now excavated from her mind's sojourn among that ancient, inhuman race. The clock topped a ring of counters. Behind them, harried clerks dispensed guidance to equally harried travelers. Charlie tensed. Through our confluence, I felt him shiver with fear or joy. Or both. I followed his gaze to where a thin, black-clad figure waited, a branch parting the current. That perfection of stillness melted as we approached, and quick strides brought Ron Spector easily through the press of bodies. Spector's decisive movements and energy, startling in San Francisco or Arkham, seemed born of the station's rhythm. He clasped Charlie's hand and Caleb's with equal apparent pleasure, offered to take Trumbull's suitcase, and slung my shoulder bag across his chest as well. The rest of us fell into step behind him, save for Dee Dee, who kept pace by her old colleague's side.
You find us a place near this doctor, the one who thinks he's found Caleb's wayward cousin? She asked.
He shook his head.
There's a boarding house that I trust near my family in St. Mary's Park. Clean and good food and willing to put up with people coming and going at odd hours. And cheap enough not to scare Miss Marsh.
He glanced back only briefly, but his voice was teasing.
It's a quick enough ride to Brooklyn on the IRT Lexington Avenue line, and who knows where you'll have to go once you talk with your doctor.
That's fine, I said, though I wondered at the way Dee Dee pulled herself straighter, the hint of shortened breath that passed sudden and vivid through the confluence. It might be better not to ask. For all the intimacy of our connection, Dee Dee preferred to keep her distress private. A newsstand halted Spectre's momentum. He swung aside to examine the headlines. I wasn't surprised. They were full of the Hiss trial, Soviet spies infiltrating the American government through mundane stealth. Spectre likely knew the agents who'd tracked the man down. He must be immersed in both the rational fear of further collaborators and the hysteria that President Truman warned against at the bottom of the page. There was an edge to the headlines that I didn't like. Even knowing a fraction of what Spectre's masters feared, I could guess at the tensions swelling. Frightened people would look for enemies and find them. Spectre straightened, shook his head, and led us down to the subway station. Tiled walls created an echoing cave of footsteps and muddled conversation, but the crowd was sparser. I was relieved to see signs forbidding cigarettes and pipes, my throat still stung after the ride from Boston. Even so, the platform air was a stew, half-spoiled food, urine, sweat, faded perfumes, and musks. It cloyed and teased, wavering curtains of rot blowing aside for a moment to reveal hints of lust and roses.
"We'd better move farther down the platform. More room for your luggage near the front of the train."
Spectre's voice recalled me to practicalities. I followed, watching his confident stride. This was why, despite all my doubts, we'd asked for his help finding our way around New York. On his native soil, he offered the best chance of finding what we sought. That, and the pleasure his company brought Charlie, were sufficient arguments for his presence. Still, it rankled. I'd come to like Spectre the last time we worked together, but until now I'd never gone to him for help. He'd always approached me first. And while he'd proven himself largely trustworthy, he was an agent of the state, and some of his colleagues were far less honorable. He was here with us now on his own time, but he could not be counted on to offer help alone, even if he wanted to. The state had destroyed Innsmouth. Asking for Spectre's help as we tried to rebuild came perilously close to suggesting they could make up for that crime. The train cried its arrival, a long, piercing scream like a monster in mourning. Inside, bodies pressed close. The smell was worse than anything in the station. It was nothing like the ticketed train up the coast, one passenger per seat, nor like the open cable cars in San Francisco. I held my breath and clutched my valise. Far better to think of the train from the camp to San Francisco, full of familiar sweat and freely mixed Japanese and English chatter, and not of an earlier trip in boxcars smelling of rotted fish. I closed my eyes, listened. Around me, voices rose in a dozen accents of English, some Eastern European tongue, the unmistakable weaving rhythm of Chinese. My ears rang painfully, but my breathing slowed. It sounded more like San Francisco than like anywhere else I'd lived. Eventually, I opened my eyes. The train shook and rattled. Spectre shifted easily with the movement, rocking slightly as if on a boat. Dee Dee kept a hand lightly on the back of a nearby seat. She too adapted easily to the ragged sway. A pale young man gave up his seat to Charlie, who settled in with a nod and pulled his cane close to avoid others' legs and ankles. The rest of us gripped poles and handbars, trying our best not to trip into the sea of strangers. Neko caught my eye and nodded, wan smile betraying her own nerves. The press eased as we left Manhattan. The remaining riders wore darker clothes, more mended, with scarves or strange small hats pulled tight against their skulls. Finally, Spectre led us out onto a smaller platform, then up to the street. For the first time, I tasted the city's open air.
"Welcome to the Bronx."
Spectre sounded uncharacteristically shy. San Francisco, the city I knew best, stretched over ancient hills and endless fog. It was easy to imagine its topography stripped of human habitation, grown wild with the strange plants and stranger animals that would cover it through eons without witness, and to imagine it reborn long after humanity was dust, hills only a little eroded, as a new city for another species. Not so New York. I knew we stood on an upthrust of bedrock, scarcely 5 miles from the open water of the Atlantic. But the honking cars, the grocers and delis and hardware stores and veterinarians squeezed together with no apparent pattern, the sidewalk crammed with food carts and families, all seemed crafted on a foundation of human whim alone. Newsstands blared civilized horror,
Bloodshed in China, Soviet spies in America, magazines speculating about push-button warfare. Exhaust mingled with tobacco smoke and the scent of hot dogs and pickles, sweat and aged dirt and oil and disinfectant. No hint of salt water could wind through that tapestry. And yet, Spectre relaxed into this rhythm. The street hummed. Its shifting vibration made me want to pull off my shoes and let the energy course through me. I wanted to ride and gentle it as I might.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.